Okay, hello everyone, good morning. Just let me know whether I'm audible or not so that we could officially begin, and whether you're able to see my screen or not. Let me know in the comment section so that we can all start. Okay, thank you everyone. I can just I just cross-checked. I can see the screen and hear myself just fine. Fine, so let's quickly begin with today's session. So once again, good morning everyone, and welcome to this session on OpenCV. And I have actually termed this particular session as image blurring. So we'll be learning a couple of things related to what exactly is image blur and how do we use this particular concept of image blur. And maybe, you know, normally you might have definitely seen, say there is an image, just like what I have put here. I have just put one simple quote here which says, say when life gets blurry, adjust your focus, all right? This is the image which I have here. So basically what we will be working on is, again, with the help of Python as our base, okay? We will be using Python as our base, and with the help of that, we will be actually writing a code wherein we can get our image to be, you know, blurred wherever we want, okay? So whichever part of the image we want to get it blurred, we can do that. And whichever part of the image you want to keep it as it is, you can keep it as it is. All right. So today we will be specifically working on blurring of an image, although you can apply the same for any other thing, right? So if you want to say, maybe, you know, apply any other filter, say you want to apply focusing filter, you can feel free to do that. If you want to apply, say, some other sort of filter, maybe, you know, you want to apply, say, something on edge detection kind of a filter, you can apply that particular thing also. All right, but then today we will be focusing only on image blurring, and I will be telling you how you can obviously go ahead and work on different projects also, so that you can continue working on the same. All right, and we will be using Python as the base here, as I have told you. And if we are using Python as a base, definitely we would need Python to be installed in our laptop, all right, laptop or computer. So I would expect that everyone is working on a laptop or a computer. And I will be telling you from scratch how you can download Python as a software, and also how you can actually say download the library which we'll be using. We will be actually using OpenCV as the library, and with the help of OpenCV we will learn some of the methods which we are going to use for that particular thing. All right, so let me first come out of this particular PPT, all right, and then I will open up a new window here. So I would say that today's session is the continuation of one of the session which I had taken on OpenCV. I will go to YouTube here. And if I, okay, if I go to Diazonic Labs, so you should be able to see when I go inside this, let me just scroll down. You should be able to see one webinar which we had conducted just a month ago, which was about the basics of computer vision. So I would say today's session is the continuation of what we had learned actually during that time. All right, so we had learned about, say, how you can use image and how you can do a little bit of image processing. right? So today's session is the continuation of that. So it's not compulsory that you should know whatever I have taught you inside this particular webinar. Not compulsory. Today's webinar also can go ahead with that. But then I would suggest you to please refer back to this particular video if you want to get strong hold of, you know, what exactly is computer vision and how you can say play around with image processing with the help of computer vision library in Python. All right, so the link for this particular thing, I will put it in the description below. Okay, I will put it in the chat section so that you can watch it later after today's webinar is over. So I can say that today's webinar is part two of computer vision, and many more parts will be continuing regarding this particular thing. So I want you guys to quickly like the video which you are watching so that I can understand how many people are actually here. Can you quickly, guys, like the video? Please like the video and please do consider subscribing to our channel if you are new to our channel. Once you have liked our video, I will understand how many people are there. I can see maybe, you know, 50 people live now. I want everyone to please click on like button. Can you please click on like button? This will actually motivate me enough to begin with the session. All right. Okay, so great. Let's quickly delve into the session. As I was telling you, today's session is all about Python software. So the first thing what you will have to do is you will have to go to python.org. And once you go to python.org, you can go to, say, download section here. Click on downloads. And then if you scroll down, the latest version what is out here is 3.8.6. And within a week, Python 3.9 will also be available for the public. Okay, so but for now we are using Python 3.8. So you can please download Python 3.8. What I would suggest you to do is please scroll down till here. Okay, if you scroll down here, you should be able to see Python 3.8.5, I think. So this is the most stable version. Go inside this Python 3.8.5, and if you scroll down till the very end, right, you should be able to see executable installer. There is something called as executable installer. So depending upon your operating system, whether you are using, say, 32-bit operating system or 64-bit operating system, you can just click on this executable installer and install Python. All right, so please click on this executable installer. This is the best way how you can actually install the Python software. All right, so that will be better if you are doing this particular thing what I'm telling you. Let me also click on it and show you how exactly it is getting installed. So this is what you will get here: Python 3.8.5 AMD 64-bit. All right, install this particular thing, and after you click on this, I will show you one specific feature which you will have to remember, because it will be easy for us to actually install OpenCV library. So I will go inside this. Just give me a moment and let me show you what exactly you will have to work upon. All right, so the moment you open the installation or that particular file, right, you will get something like this. So the photo is of 3.7.1, but then yes, if you are installing 3.8.5, you will have similar option like this. The most important thing which I want you to do is please make sure that you add 3.7 to path. Okay, this particular thing you will have to tick mark this and then click on install now. Tick mark this particular thing and then click on install now. All right, this is what you need to do. Please make sure that you go to the website which I have specified, okay, and then download this. Once you have downloaded, double click on this, you will get something like this. Please make sure that you click this particular thing, you add the Python 3.7 to path and then click on install now. Once you click on install now, your Python software should be installed. Okay, this is what you need to do. As simple as this, this is what you need to do. I'll wait for everyone to make sure that they have installed this particular software. And if you have any questions, guys, regarding the installation, please do ask me. I will be helping you out with that. All right. So once you have installed this particular software, I'll tell you how to check whether your software is also installed or not. Just go to Start menu and type in IDLE. Type in IDLE. And this open this IDLE, it should open up like this. Okay, this particular thing should open up. So I'll give you a couple of minutes to make sure that you have installed maybe, you know, the latest version of Python, and more specifically 64-bit of Python. And once you have installed this, you will be ready to go for the installation of OpenCV. All right. So can you quickly do it? And once it is done, please let me know in the comment section. Please repeat the steps again. You are too fast. Okay. I will go very slow. So you will have to go to python.org, and in python.org, go to download section. And once you are in download section, please select 64-bit executable installer. 64-bit executable installer. 64 because I am using 64-bit operating system. Yours, it might be 32-bit. But then please select this particular thing. Okay, it will install 64-bit or 32-bit as desired. All right. Once it is installed here, let me just pass you the code. 1 second. Okay. I will just give you the link. I think so. The link is given. All right. So from that particular thing, you will have to, you know, work upon the project. Okay. This is the link which I have, I think so, shared. Okay. So please make sure that you download it. Okay, and after you download it for installation, please make sure that you have added this. Make sure that you have added this particular thing here. Okay, as I have shown. Okay, I will be expecting everyone to have completed this particular thing. Once you are done with this, I have told you to actually open up your IDLE, go to Start menu and type in IDLE, and you will get something like this, Python 3.7 64-bit, and it should open up like this. Okay, it should open up like this. So that means you have installed Python into your software. You have installed Python software into your laptop or your computer. Now the second step is you will have to make sure that you have to install, say, OpenCV. All right. Let's see how we can install OpenCV. Okay. What if I have already installed Python but not added it? So Shamli, what you will have to do is you will have to actually add up the paths. There is something called as path environment path variable. Okay, which you will have to do. That particular thing is going to be a little bit difficult for you now, but then let me tell you how you can do that also. So this is only for those people who have actually added, who have actually downloaded Python, but then they are not able to, pass on the path. So let me tell you what you'll have to do. You'll have to go to IDE, and then here you will have option called as open file location. All right. Open the file location of this particular thing. And afterwards, open or do right click, go to open file location. Once again, you should be able to see something called as Python 37 here. All right, you should be able to see something called as Python 37 here. And once you are able to see this Python 37 or Python, whatever this particular thing it is there, you can then actually check for scripts folder, go to scripts folder. And here, this is the place. Okay, this is the place where you will have to copy this particular path location and install the OpenCV library. Okay, install the OpenCV library. This is what you need to do. Shamli Yadav, all right? So if you have installed Python and if you have forgotten to add the path, you should actually come to this scripts folder and then copy this scripts folder. And let me open up my command prompt here. So I will go to start menu. I will open command prompt. CMD is what I will type. And it should open up command prompt for me. So basically, by default, you will be in C users administrators. This is what I have got. Okay. You might be in your administrator folder. But then those people who have forgotten to add the path, who have not added the path, you will have to write CD space control V. That means you should go to scripts folder. All right. Make sure that you are in scripts folder of your Python. And in this particular place, you will have to give one specific, code. You should write pip install opencv python. Okay. And other people, just open up your command prompt. Just open up your command prompt and type in directly pip install opencv python. Okay. This is what you need to do. Pretty simple, guys. Don't get confused. Okay, I was just telling for, those people who have forgotten to add this particular path, or maybe, you have already opened up your Python. You have already made sure that Python is installed. For those people, what you will have to do is you will have to go to scripts folder of your Python from your location, and then you will have to type in CD space that particular location and press enter. And afterwards, once you are inside scripts folder, you will have to type in this particular command, pip install opencv python. Type in pip install opencv python. Okay, that's it. Type in pip install opencv python. Installing opencv in system. Let me just type in, say, open command prompt. And type the following. All right, so I will give you another couple of minutes to make sure that your OpenCV is installed. These are the two things which you will have to do. So please let me know in the comment section once it is done so that we can continue. Okay, we need these two things to happen. Please let me know whether it is done or not. If you have any queries regarding this, please ask me. I will help you out. Okay, so Shamli Yadav, I hope it is done for you. Your installation of OpenCV is properly done. Okay, Kanishk, I will wait for another minute or so. Okay, let me show you how you will get the result. So when you type in pip install opencv, 1 second. When you type in pip install opencv python and press enter, you should be seeing one specific bar which will be downloading that particular library. All right, so I have already downloaded this, and that is why I get here requirement already satisfied. Okay, I am getting this requirement already satisfied. That means I have already downloaded my software or the library which I needed to actually work upon. All right, this is the same thing which you will also have to follow. If you want to install any other library, you will have to follow the same procedure. You'll have to type in pip install. Say you want to install NumPy, just type in your NumPy. If you want Matplotlib, type in Matplotlib. Whatever other software you need, right? You can just type in here and you will get the output for that. Okay, so let's continue. I would consider that everyone has finished installing this particular thing. Now, once this is done, okay, what we'll do is we will quickly have the basics ready. Okay, so let's write a simple code here in our Python, this one. So once we are getting this particular thing, our shell, you will have to go to file, okay, and click on new file. Go to file and click on new file so that you can write the code here. I will be taking a simple image and displaying here, okay? I will take one simple image from Google and I will display here, okay? This is what we'll do so that we are, you know, okay with the basics of OpenCV. First, we should be okay with the basics of OpenCV, and afterwards, we can go ahead and add up, say, whatever blurring you want to actually work upon, all right? So let's continue. I will type in here, say, import CV2, all right? And then after this is done, I will type in here, say, img as my variable. And afterwards, I will write, say, cv2.imread. I am using the image read function, wherein I can actually read up my image, okay? And what is that image name? We still don't know yet, okay? So I will keep it as it is, plain blur, all right? So I will not write anything because I will have to first download the image. And after this is done, I'm gonna write in here, say cv2.imshow. Okay, I want to show that particular image. So I will type in, say, my image window name. It should be just say image output. Okay. And afterwards, I will write, say, comma img. Okay, this is what I write. And after this is done, I will have to specify two more methods of CV2. If you remember, I had already taught you this in the previous session also. So the first one is wait key. Okay, let's wait. And then afterwards, it should destroy all windows. All right. So these are the methods which we will be using. Okay. Once again, let me specify the methods which we are using. First one is reading the image. The second one is showing that particular image and then waiting for infinite amount of time until one specific key is pressed and then destroying the new window which was open. All right. These are the four methods of CV2 library which we are using. Okay. So now I have to specify here which image am I opening and showing. So for that, I will go to Google. Okay. Let me go to Google and let me download one specific image. All right. Let me download any image of your choice. Please download it. So okay, I think so. There's one thing which I have already taken here. Person lost. Okay, so I will take one specific image from here. I think so. This looks good. All right, so let me open up. Okay, not this. So I will take one specific image from Google. Okay, because I can, you know, use it very easily for blurring and all of it. So that will be better. And here I will save it in. Let me create a new folder here. And let me type, say, image blur, okay, on my desktop, and I will save this particular image there. So let me type here, say, PIC, and it is in JPG format, so I will save it. I have saved one specific image now, okay? I will just read out that particular image, or I will maybe, you know, read that particular image and show you how exactly does it work. So I will go back here, and then my image name is what? It is PIC.jpg. All right. So if I want to run this particular program, I will have to save it. So let me save this particular program and I will save it in the same folder where I have put the image from Google. All right. And I will type in here, say P1 simple. Okay. P1 simple is what I will write. And let me save it. And once it is done, let me go to run, click on run module. Okay, click on run module. It should open up one image. Okay, it is opening up one image for me here. Okay, whatever I have taken, it is opening up for me. So it is working all fine. And how do I close it? Just press close and it should get closed. All right, pretty simple. This is what we need to do. All right, this is what we need to do. Yes, Vishal, I was waiting for everyone to speed up so that no one is missed. All right. Okay, I hope everyone has got this. This is again the basics. I have already told you this particular thing in the previous session also, how we are actually reading the image and how we are actually just displaying it on the screen. All right, so let's move on and do something informative regarding the focusing of blur. I wanted to make sure that my image is actually opening up and it is working completely fine. All right. So I will come back to my, say, presentation here. And let me speak a little bit about, say, blur filters. What exactly are blur filters and how do we use them? All right. So that is the topic for today, right? So let's see how we can actually use them. Now, if you talk about, say, focus or blur, so these are all called as filters. Okay, so you will have to understand what exactly is a filter and how do we use this particular filter in our, say, OpenCV library. All right, so talk about anything. You can talk about, say, sharpening of an image or, say, blurring of an image, focusing of an image, or maybe, you know, finding the edge detection. These are all called as filters. All right, so you can specify or you can apply one specific filter on top of an image. All right. Now, how exactly do you define a filter? You can call filter or a kernel also, both refer to the same thing, all right? So you can consider that a filter to be a small matrix, okay? First of all, you need to understand what exactly is an image. Image is nothing but one specific kind of data wherein it consists of many amount of pixels, all right? There is something called as pixels. We also call them as a picture element, all right? So this particular pixels are actually broken up into you know, lots of values, and then you get a matrix. You get a very big matrix with the help of those pixels. You get a very big matrix. Now, if you apply one specific filter on top of that image, okay, so you apply one specific filter on top of that image and you apply it to an entire image, that is when we can actually apply maybe, you know, a blurring filter or, say, edge detection filter or, say, focus filter or whatever it is. All right, so once again, to define what exactly is a filter or a kernel, it is a small matrix which is applied to an entire image. So now you might have the question, how can you apply one small filter or one small matrix to an entire image? Because the image, whatever we are taken, okay, let me just show you this. So I will go to, say, let me just go to the new folder which I have created just now. What was the name of the folder? One second. I think so I had created. Okay, what is the folder name? I forgot. Let me check. It was image blur, right? So let me check for image blur. Yeah, it's here. So I have taken this particular photo, right? What I'll do is I will go to this particular photo, right click, go to properties. And if I go to, say, details here, and if I scroll down, you should be able to see the dimensions here. It says that it has got 1024 pixels as width pixels and then 683 as height pixels. All right, we have got rows versus columns. So if you have something in rows versus columns, you can very well represent that particular thing in the form of a matrix. All right, you can very well, say, represent that particular thing in the form of matrix. And on that matrix, we are actually specifying or we are actually putting up a small matrix or a small filter here. Okay, say 3x3. So on 1000 versus 1000 cross 800 image, you are specifying 3x3 filter on everything. Okay, and that particular procedure of applying an image, applying a small matrix on a bigger image, okay, that particular thing is actually called as convolution. All right, you might have definitely heard about this convolution. So basically, the process of passing the kernels over an image is what is called as convolution. All right, and the filters which are referred are called as convolution kernels. All right, so if you are someone in, say, deep learning, interested in deep learning, you might have definitely heard about this convolution. And the basics of convolution is, again, applying this particular filters itself. All right, so when you apply one specific kind of filters, that is when you get convolution. All right, so you might have heard about convolutional neural network. Inside that, the first layer is again convolutional kernel layer. All right, so this is again the base wherein you apply one specific kind of filter. What kind of filter do you apply? That is different thing. All right, we have got different types of filters. We have got blur filter, we have got focus filter, we have got lot of different types of filters which I will be showing you. All right, so there is this particular say URL which I want you to actually go through. So it is called as setosa.io. okay, setosa.io. so please go to this particular website. I have kept it here. Just type in setosa.io. you should be actually understanding what exactly are the concepts of image filters. Okay, so image filters or image kernels. So let's go inside this. I will open up my browser and I will put it down here. So it is setosa.io/ev/image kernels. Okay, so please go to this particular website and you should be able to see something called as image kernels. And once you have got image kernels here, you can just scroll down. Let us work on this particular thing. Let us work on, say, this particular thing. The link is given to you in the description. Okay, you can just check it out. All right, so what exactly does this particular image kernel tells us? What exactly does it tell us? So if you see here, you are able to see black and white image. Okay, you have got one specific phase, black and white image. All right, this is the real size image which we have. I think so it is of 32x32 pixels. All right, it's a very small, tiny image which we have here. I'm not sure how much values is this particular thing, but then yes, it is very small, right? I think so it is 28x28 or 32x32. I'm not sure. If you count this number of pixels, you will actually understand how much pixels does it have. So this is the real size image anyway, okay? And it is just zoomed out like this, okay? So it is maybe, you know, completely shown to you. And obviously it looks like a blurred image. And here the pixel values are actually shown from 0 to 255, whatever the pixel values are there, it is actually shown here, all right? And then now if you scroll down, you should be able to see, let's walk through applying following 3x3, okay? We are applying 3x3 kernel on the image. Okay, so there are a lot of kernels which are available. So one of the kernel is sharpen kernel. Apart from that, see, we have got blur kernel, we have got bottom swivel. These are all the different types of kernels which are actually default values. You don't have to worry about that. These are all selected. All right, so now that I have selected sharpen kernel, you should be able to see this is the input image and this is the output image which we have. All right, you should be able to see, if you see from a little bit far right, you should be able to see that the image is kind of sharpened. All right, kind of sharpened, this particular image. All right, and if you see some other, this one, maybe, you know, I will give say blur here, you should be able to see here the kernel value changes now. All right, the filter value is changed, and then you should be able to see the blurred output image in compared to the input whatever we have. All right, I hope you are able to understand this particular thing clearly, what exactly I'm trying to refer with the help of say kernels, whatever it is there. All right, so this is what is called as the concept of say blurring an image, and the process which we use for doing this is called as convolution. Now let me specify what exactly is convolution also. Convolution, as I have told you, it actually passes smaller filter on top of bigger image, right? And the process what it specifies is, you know, addition. It actually adds up the image value. See, this is the kernel value, right? 0.0625 is the kernel value. If you see here, it will take, say, first 9 values. If you see here on the left hand side, I have got first 9 pixels, which are actually multiplied with say 0.0625. And then 205 is the second pixel. It is multiplied with 0.125. And then the third pixel is 247. It is multiplied with again 0.0625. You multiply each and every pixel with the image filter value, whatever it is there. And then afterwards you sum it up. You sum it up. And you get here totally 178. 178 is the new pixel which we are getting. Okay, 178 is the new pixel which we are getting from our older values. Okay, you actually multiply the value and then you add them up so that you get this particular thing as your output. Once you do that, this is when you understand that you are actually blurring an image. All right, I hope this is pretty much clear. If you want to play around with different values, different pixels also, you can play around. So I think so I have shown you sharpen. Let me show you outline. So if you see here, you should be able to see the outline image here. I have taken only the outline value of this particular thing. Okay, so this is how it works, guys. This is how this particular thing is actually working. Now that you have understood all of this, our main job is to apply on our image, right? So we have taken this particular thing as our main image. Where is it? Let me just open it up. So this is the image which we have downloaded. We will have to apply blurring on this particular image. How do I apply blurring on this particular image is the major question. Okay, so let's do the same thing. Let's apply blurring image here. So this is the first demo which I'm showing you. There is one more thing which I want to show you. Let me just type in here filter kernel, okay, on Google, filter say kernels, okay, and then I will type say Wikipedia, and the moment I type here I will get kernel image processing, okay, kernel image processing in Wikipedia, right? So if I scroll down here again, it tells us the same thing: blurring, sharpening, embossing, edge detection, and many more. All right, if you see here, these are all the values or the kernels which we are getting here. So if you take this particular kernel, you will get image result as it is. This is the identity kernel which we have. Then we have got edge detection. Then we have got sharpen image. Then we have got box blur. We have got Gaussian blur. We have got Gaussian blur of different kernel sizes. And then we have got unsharp masking. We have got a lot of kernels here. Okay, we have got a lot of kernels which are actually specified here. All right. So these are all the different types of things which are actually available here, which are actually given to us, right? So our main focus will be to actually use, say, maybe, you know, this particular, say, box blur, or maybe, you know, Gaussian blur, or say this particular blur, what we have, the normal blur, what we have here. Okay. And apply it on our channel, apply it on our respective image. All right. So let's start coding. So what I'll do is I will come back to my code here. Okay. And I will have to apply one specific blur value, right? So I will put this on the right hand side, and on the left hand side, I have got this blur value. So it is 0.0625. I will have to take this particular value inside my image. All right. So for doing that, I will have to specify one library. I will have to use, say, NumPy library for that. So let me use NumPy library and let me start doing the same. Okay, so just give me a moment. All right, so I'm gonna import NumPy library, import NumPy as np. Okay, this is the library which I need to import. Now, if you ask me that we have not imported NumPy library, you can easily do it by just going back to, say, your administrator here and then type in pip install NumPy. So basically, for numerical Python, you actually need this particular library, although it will get installed the moment you install OpenCV Python, right? It says that the one of the requirement is to install NumPy. If in case NumPy is not installed, you can please install here by typing in pip install NumPy in your command prompt. Okay, if in case it is not there, all right? So I have taken your NumPy library, and after taking the NumPy library, I will take one kernel here, all right? So I have read up this particular image. I will take kernel is equal to np.array. Okay, why am I taking np? np is the short form which I will take. And then inside this, I will specify the values here, the same values. 0.0625 is what I need to specify, right? So I will take a matrix. Matrix will contain two dimensions. So I will put two brackets here, and then I will write, say, 0.0625. Okay. This is the first value which I need. The second value which I need is 0.125. This is the second value. The third value is 0.0625. Okay. This is the third value. Let me close the bracket here. And then the first bracket, this is the first row which I have written. And then the second row, it is actually beginning here, 0.125, and then 0.25, and then 0.125 again. All right, this is the second one, comma, enter, and then give tab space and type in here the same thing which I have taken in the beginning, right? This is the same thing here. So let me copy this and let me paste it here. All right. It is the same thing. So I have taken a kernel here. All right. I have taken this particular thing as my kernel size. I hope this particular kernel size is all clear. I've just copied and pasted the values here, whatever it is there. All right. So this is my blur kernel. Now that I have got blur kernel, what is the next thing which I will have to specify? The next thing which I will have to specify is use a filter or use a convolutional layer, right? So how do I do that? I will have to specify DST or DST as my variable or whatever variable I want. CV2.filter. Okay, so the filter name which I'm using is filter 2D. Okay, why is it 2D? 2D because I'm using two dimension here. And here I will have to specify three different things. The first one is source. Source as in on top of what you are putting. So you are actually putting this on top of IMG, right? If you remember, we have taken something called as IMG. So I will specify here IMG, okay? And then the second thing is depth. I will give depth very smaller one, minus one is what I will give depth. This is the common one. And then the third thing is I will have to apply it on top of kernel. Okay, I will have to apply it on top of kernel. So basically what happens, it will take the image source pixels, whatever it is there, and then it will specify the kernel operation on top of it. That's it. This is what we need to do. And after this is done, I will specify. So let me show the output. This is the image input. Okay. And then this is image output. And here I will run for DST. Okay. This is what I will have to do. So once this is done, hopefully everything is right. Let me save it and let me run it. Okay, invalid token. All right, so here, yeah. Zero, and now let me run it. Okay, invalid token. So I will have to change it, yes. And there you go, let me run this. So you should be able to see the output image with respect to input image, and it is completely blurred. All right, you might not be able to find the exact difference here on my screen, but then please check, you should be able to get some sort of blurness, right? Some sort of blur is actually shown here. Yes, Pratik, thank you for that. I got the output. So I am actually able to see the blur difference between the two images. All right, I'm not sure whether you are able to see it or not, but then I am definitely able to see the difference between the two. All right, so this is the simple blur which we have actually applied. All right, this is the simple blur which we have actually applied. You can also check it out, the simple blur which I have applied here, and I'm getting the output. What I'm gonna do is to actually help you understand this particular thing even better, I will take, say, one specific quote. All right, quote I will write. And let me take nice quote here. Okay, let me take this as the quote which I want. I will save the image. Let me type in as a ABC, and hopefully this is saved. What I'll do here is I will type say ABC. Okay, and let me run this and check. So this is the output image. You I think so. Now you can see the difference. See, I am able to see it clearly, although I'm not given here the most of the, you know, highest kernel size. Maybe, you know, there is no much of blur, but then this is the simple blur which I have actually worked upon. All right, this is the simple blur which I have actually worked upon, and this is what we get as the output. All right, so this is the image which is input, and this is the blurred image which we have. This is the blurred image which we have. All right, so yes, this is how we actually apply say one specific kernel value on top of whatever values or on top of whatever the image we have taken. Okay, so I will stop here and take up your questions if you have any. If you have understood, if you are getting the output for this particular thing, then you should understand the basics of Photoshop. So basically we are learning what exactly is happening in the Photoshop, right? How you are using this particular Photoshop exercise to, you know, work on whatever the technique you are doing. Okay, so one thing is very clear here. If you want to give your own array, you will have to write it like this, and then you'll have to use filter 2D. Okay, you will have to use filter 2D as your imaging method. But then what if you don't want to write all of this? Who will remember all of this? That is why OpenCV has actually come up with its own kernels. All right, its own kernels. They're called as types of image blurring. There are different types of image blurring. We have got normal blur or averaging blur. Apart from that, we have got Gaussian blur. We have got median blur or filtering. We have got bilateral filtering. All right, these are all the different types of image blurring which are actually available all by itself in Python as a language. It is available directly in Python as a language. But before going to image blur, I will show you one specific example of, say, edge detection, okay, so that you understand that there is a difference between the two. What I will do is I will go to kernel size here, and let me take this particular as my edge detection. All right, -1, -1, -1 is what I need to write, right? So I will go back here and I will specify here, say, kernel one, and let me put all of this in, say, I'll put this in comment, all right, so that okay, and after this is done, I will take up, say, one more kernel. Kernel is equal to np dot array of, all right, and then let me specify here. So I will take, say, let me start with this 1, 0, -1. Okay, this is the first thing which I will take, and then the second thing which I want to take is 0, 0, 0, and then the last thing is, I think, so the same thing again. Okay, it is the other way around. It is -1, 0, 1. All right, close it. There you go. This is what I have done. Save it and run. Okay, so yes, there you go. This is what is the Sobel kernel which we have. See here, input image I have taken in this particular manner. It is actually detecting the out, whatever the output you want it to check. Output, or we can call it as, say, the edge detection. All right. It is actually detecting the edge here. All right. So you're able to see this particular thing. I have just changed the kernel size. Okay. Don't get confused. I've just changed the kernel values, whatever I want. And I'm getting this particular thing as my output. Okay, I hope this is clear. Now, the next thing what I want to do is I will use this particular kernel value which I have got, -1, -1, -1. Now, let me change it, okay, so that you will be able to see -1. So next thing is, say, -1. And here it is 8. Everywhere it is -1, right? So these are all the kernel values which are available. -1 and then -1 again and -1. Okay, so save and run. Now you should be able to see much clearer image. Okay. Are you able to see this? It is detecting the edge very neatly, right? This is also detecting the edge very neatly. Now, the whole point or the conclusion, what I want you to actually understand from this is, whatever be it, say, blurring, be it embossing, be it, say, edge detecting, it is nothing but applying one specific filter on top of that particular image. Okay, that is the end goal. You are just applying a filter on top of it. Once you apply the filter on top of it, you will get the output as shown. Okay, you will get the output based on this particular thing. All right, so this values, whatever it is there, I'm taking directly from Wikipedia. All right, it is not my own values. I'm taking directly from Wikipedia. Whichever values you want, you can actually specify. All right. And it will work based on that particular thing. So you can try out different things, whatever it is there here, you can try out. And now we will come back to our blurring thing only. Okay, so the next thing what we need to actually do is we will take the image and we will check, instead of writing this again and again, right? Like, I don't want to specify, say, filter 2D and kernel value. I don't want to specify kernel value. Instead of that, what if we directly use, say, normal blur, or what if we use, say, Gaussian blur or median blur, whatever it is there. How do we use that particular thing? I'm going to show you that. Okay, so now the best way to actually learn, many people ask me about documentation. Okay, the best way to learn all of this is just type in here, say, Python open CV documents. Okay, Python open CV documentation is what you'll have to type in. And if you go inside this Python tutorials, you should be able to see. See here, there are a lot of options here. Maybe, you know, for image processing, GUI, introduction to image, or whatever it is there. Go to image processing here. And here you should be able to see. One second. You should be able to see here smoothing of images, right? Go to smoothing of images. And here you will have different things. See here, 2D convolution. This is what we have used. So CV filter 2D is what we have used, right? Apart from that, if you want some other things, see here, we have got image blurring, which is of averaging. In averaging, this is the filter which is considered. This is the filter which is considered by default. You can use cv.blur. Okay, directly use cv.blur and specify the kernel size. Specify the kernel size which you want, and you will end up getting the output. All right, you will end up getting the output here. So the kernel size is again very important here. How much kernel size you are actually taking? Let me tell you what exactly is kernel size and how is it determining the value. So basically, as I've told you about filter or kernel, it is a fixed size of array of numerical coefficients, and then you will have to specify how much kernel size you want to actually take. Should it be 3x3? Should it be 5x5? Should it be 7x7? Whatever it is, please remember, kernel size should always be in say odd number. It should be always in odd number. It can't be in even number. It should always be in odd number. All right, this is what you need to specify. So I'll just take up few comments. If there are any questions, let me check and then move around. So thankful. Okay, I'm glad that you liked it, Ruth. Thank you so much, sir. You have mentioned, yes, Pratik, I saw that. Then thank you, very informative. Thanks a lot, John. Patricia, thank you. Glad that you are enjoying the workshop. Rafa Tatel, okay, wow, okay, yeah, that's good. Jesselyn, I hope you're getting the output. John, thank you. Johnny Lowe, thank you. Novelin, oh my god, okay, I hope you're getting the output anyways. So I love the output, Novelin, yes, okay, that's great. Habib Ansari, thanks a lot, man. Okay, Rafa Tatel, how about me? What about you? Please notice me. Okay, yes, I hope you're getting the output. Thank you for this wonderful session, Menaga. Yes, thanks a lot. Hope you're liking it, Patricia. Yes, okay, fine. There are no queries. I hope everyone is getting the output. Please do consider liking this video, guys. Please like the video. I can't see a lot of likes on my video. Please do consider liking the video and subscribe to our channel. If you have not subscribed, we will be coming up with free webinars every weekend. So please do consider subscribing to our YouTube channel if you have not done it, and please like the video, guys. Please, I want some likes to come onto my video so that I understand that you guys are watching it and liking it. All right, so let's move on back into this particular thing. Let's move on. Okay, please repeat once again, Abid. What do you want me to repeat? If you're talking about kernel, again, as I've told you, it is a fixed size of numerical coefficients. We can call it as a kernel or a filter. Both are referring to the same thing, and this particular thing will be used for convolution. Again, as I've told you, convolution is simply an element wise multiplication between two matrix. You actually take, say, 9x9. If your filter kernel size is, say, 3x3, then you take 3x3 value from the original image. You do convolution as in element wise multiplication, and then you add all of the values. Once you have added all of the values, you will get that particular thing as your the final output value. Okay, once you have got the final output value, you can actually understand working on it. All right, so once that particular thing is clear, we can now move on. As I was talking to you about, say, normal blur or Gaussian blur, we'll not be discussing all types of blur. I will just discuss maybe, you know, normal blur and Gaussian blur. Apart from that, median and bilateral, you can please try it out and find the difference. The simplest difference which I want to actually specify is the difference between the kernel values. Whatever the kernel values are there, these are changing in each and every type of blurring. All right, that is the only difference on a general thing what we have here. All right, so let's continue and move on. So I will go back to this, and as I've told you, I will be using now cv2.blur. All right, let's use cv blur option and check whether we are getting the output. What I'll do is I will keep this particular code as it is. I will copy this, control A, control C, control, let me open up a new file here, and I will paste it here. All right, and let me delete all of the other things which I don't need. So kernel, I don't need here. I will not be using cv2 filter also. Okay, instead of cv2 filter, what I'll use is cv2.blur. Right, let me use cv2.blur, and inside this I will have to specify only two things. The first thing is source, what I want. The second thing is what should be my kernel size, and kernel size will be in the form of say 3x3 or 5x5. As I've told you, it will be only the odd value. I will give 3x3 first, and then I will maybe, you know, make it bigger to 9x9 or 5x5 and then 7x7. Okay, this is what I will do. Simple. I have not changed. I've changed instead of say filter 2D, I've just put blur. Let's see whether we are getting the output or not. So I will type in say P2 and blur. So let me save it and let me run it. You should be able to get the output. I am getting here the output here. This is blurred image. Okay, whatever it is there, it is completely blurred here. So this is the blurring which I get. Instead of remembering the convolutional filter value, you can just specify cv2.blur and it should work. All right. I will specify a higher end value. So let me specify say 5x5 and let me run this. And you can see the blurring effect is now even more for whatever this particular value it is there, right? It is even more blurred. All right. I will specify one more bigger one. Let me specify say 9x9 now so that you understand how exactly it is different, right? So let me run this and there you go. Now you should be able to see the actual difference between the two. All right. This is the image input and this is the image output which we have. So this is how we actually use the concept of blurring. So with the usage of image blur, we are getting something like this. Okay, this is what we have. So this is how we actually end up getting the output, all right? And you can play around with different blurring values. Whatever values you need, you can play around with that particular thing also. All right. So the cv2.blur is the most simplest function which we have. Apart from that, you can also go ahead with, say, Gaussian blur. Okay, what you want to do with Gaussian blur, you can actually go ahead and do that particular thing as well. Okay, now that we have learned till here, the next thing, see, this actually completes our first part of the session, all right? And the second part, moving on with the second part, what we need to do is, I will show you a practical application of this and then you will understand it even more better. So what if I want to blur only a part of my image? I don't want to blur everything. I don't want to blur, say, everything. Say, I want to blur only the harder you work. I don't want to blur everything what I have here. I want to blur only say first few, whatever I want to select, I want to blur. Okay, I don't want to blur everything else. So for that, I will show you one specific application here. Maybe, you know, you might have definitely heard about, say, let me take some online tool here. There is something called as photo.com, which you can actually go to, and I'll show you a simple change here. And let me see. Let me show you that particular thing. Wait a second. So once again, I'll just type in here, say photo blur. App blur, it should work. So I'll just go directly inside the features of blur and let us see. We'll click on get started and hopefully this should come. Okay, so it is loading. Let's wait for a while. Yeah. So if you take any application, if you take any, say, Photoshop application or any, maybe, you know, you will have a lot of apps, say, talk about Snapchat filter or whatever it is there. So you will have this particular option of, you know, blurring for one specific size, whatever you want, right? So there is already this particular image and I'll just go to pixelate and show you how exactly it is done. So imagine that I want to blur this particular portion here. Okay, say I want to blur the hand here. So what do I do? I have got this particular thing to move around with me, right? I have got this particular thing with which I can actually move around, right? I can call it as a cursor. So I would need a cursor, and with the help of cursor, I can actually put this, I can pixelate this, or I can maybe, you know, blur this particular thing. I hope you are understanding. And we can also increase the kernel size here, the same thing. The kernel size, whatever it is there, you can just increase it and you can blur it, right? So I'll just blur this particular say, I'll just blur this particular cookie. And so the whole point of the matter, which I'm actually talking to you about, is I don't want to blur the complete image. Say I want to blur only a specific part of that particular image. How do I do that? And we would need this particular thing, right? Because this is the real application which we need to actually learn. Because in many of our, maybe, you know, if you want to say work around with say Photoshop or something like that, and when you are actually using a blur application, it has to be blurred only in certain kinds of values, right? It shouldn't blur everywhere, wherever it has to blur, right? It shouldn't blur the whole image. It has to blur only those parts wherein we want it to blur. We want to use something called as mouse events there. Once we use mouse events, we can actually blur that particular part of an image, right? So how do you do that in plain Python? This will be forming the second part of our session. All right. I hope you have understood what exactly we need to actually understand, right? So I will try to put up, one second, let me just open up computer and I will show you one specific thing. Just let me check whether I'm able to do this or not. So I'll go to desktop here and then image blur. I will put this particular image here and let me tell you how I need my output to be. All right. So I'll go to pixelate itself because pixelate is the better option here. Again, it is somewhat similar to image blurring. So say I want to pixelate blur, say this particular thing, pixelate or blur. Okay, please understand that I'm trying to blur here. All right. So I want to blur these two, right? This is what I need to do. I want to actually blur this particular thing and I want other things as it is. The harder I am not able to actually see because it is blurred, and all the other things, whatever I have, it should be, you know, as it is, right? So I want to actually control where I want to blur and where I don't want to blur, all right? And similarly, you can do it for focus or edge detection or whatever it is. So how do you do that? Okay, I hope the aim of the project, the next project which we'll be working on, is clearly understood, because that would form the real application. All right. So let me go back to this and let me start coding from the beginning. So what I'm going to do is I will use Control C, Control N and Control V. Okay. And let me start coding here. All right. So first thing, before even going to coding, let me come back to my presentation here. And let me talk something about mouse events. Even before using the, say, blur, you will have to understand something called as mouse events. What exactly are these mouse events? Basically, you can control your buttons of your mouse. You know that in a mouse, you have got, say, left click, you have got right click, and you use normally a lot of times, say, left button down click also. And also you use, say, mouse move, right? You use all of this particular mouse events so that one specific, say, action is actually performed, right? So we will be using this particular concept of mouse events in our project. We will actually integrate mouse events in our project of blurring. And with the help of mouse events, we can actually blur how much of our part we need to blur. We can actually select it and decide it. All right. I hope this is clear why we need to use mouse events. So what I'm going to do is the first project which I want to talk about before even integrating blur is that inside this mouse events, we will see how we can use mouse events first. And after we have understood how we can use mouse events, I'm going to create shapes, simple shapes. All right. So in OpenCV, we can create, say, simple shapes. We can create maybe, you know, a line or a rectangle or a circle or a polygon or even a text. You can even put up a text there. So we'll not worry about all of this. We'll just take a simple rectangle or a circle, because whenever you are seeing this, maybe, you know, I have shown you in this in footer also. Can you see a circle here? You need a circle to be moving around when you are moving the mouse, right? You need one specific circle, one specific shape, because from that shape itself, the blurring will happen. All right. So you need to first understand how we can use shapes in OpenCV. Okay, so let us first understand how we can use shapes in OpenCV. And once we have understood shapes in OpenCV, we can put that particular shape. Instead of that particular shape, we will put the blurring categorization or the blurring characteristics inside that. Okay, that is what we need to actually work around with. All right, so Yes. So I would say that mouse events are used in many of the languages, JavaScript, Java. It is used in processing language also. In OpenCV also, there is obviously this particular characteristics or the feature which is available. All right. So we will play around with this and check out whether this will work or not. All right. So let's move around. So I will go back to my untitled this one. So for now, I have read an image. Okay, that is good. But then I wouldn't want, say, this blurring for now. I will delete this. And I will delete the distance also. Okay, so for now, I would just need to play around. There is an interaction which we will be working on. All right, so we'll be working on this particular interaction. I will just put a simple line first. And after I put a simple line, I will be using it to, play around with the, say, circle or square or rectangle, whatever it is there. All right. So let's see what can be done. The first thing is the way we actually work upon, say, mouse events is by using specific function or a method called as set mouse call back. Okay. We'll be using set mouse call back function. And from this particular function, we need to specify here. See here, it says it needs window name. There's something called as window name, which we need to specify. And then what is the mouse event or what is the, say, function which we need to define for calling that particular mouse event. All right. So two things. First, I will write here window name itself as it is window name. And then after this, the mouse event which I want to call, let me specify this particular mouse event as, say, blur underscore project. I will write blur project because I want this particular function, since we are working ultimately on blur, I will just specify it to be blur. All right. So this blur project is a function. All right. You will have to remember that blur project is one function which we will have to define. Inside that blur project, we need to define what and all events we have and what and all events we need to actually work upon. All right. And since I have written your window name, I will specify the window name by writing, say, cv2.named window. Okay. And then here I will write, say, once again, window name. Okay. This is what I will specify. And let me write window name as one variable. Okay, this is very important. If you don't write this, you might end up not getting the proper output. So I'll just write, say, final project. Or let me write, say, final output. Okay, as my window name here, this is what I will write. Final output is what I will write. And here, instead of input image, I can call directly as window name, right? Window name. Fine. This is what I need to do. And now I need to actually define blur project. I need to define, how do I define any function in Python? I need to write here def first, and then I need to write blur underscore project. Okay, this is what, how I usually define the, say, function in a Python. Now that we have defined this particular thing, we will actually use conditional statements to check which of the functions we need to actually work upon. All right. So the first function is, or the first condition is, if, say, event, I will take one specific value as event. If event is equal to, I will specify one simplest one first. Okay. Let me take, say, event button down. Okay. This is the event value which I will take. All right. So let me specify the same here. If this is the event, okay, then what it should do, if this particular thing is the event, then it should say, just put up one specific, a line. Okay. One line should actually come out. How do I specify the line here? So for specifying the line, I should write, say, cv2.line. Okay, this is what I need to write. cv2.line is what I will specify. And inside this, I need to specify a couple of parameters. One of the parameter is, what is the source? So I will write img to be the source. Okay, because this is where we put up all of your values. The next thing is, I need to specify what is my first point, from where am I starting? So I know that the ABC pixel values, whatever I have, right? It is actually a little bit bigger, maybe, 1000 × 800 is what we had, right? So here I can just specify, say, X comma Y to be the first point, okay? And the second point I will specify to be, say, X plus, maybe, I will specify 50, okay? Because I need 50 pixels extra for X and 50 pixels extra for Y. Okay, these are the two values which I will specify. And then the third thing, the fourth thing which I need to specify here is in which, say, color do I need my line to be in. So if I want, say, black color line, I will just give 0, 0, 0. You can end up giving, say, 2, 2, 2, 55, 2, 55, 2, 55 for white session also. Okay, white line. And finally, I need to specify the thickness. I will specify the thickness to be, say, 2. Okay, this is what I need to do. Now, if you see here, we have used event, we have used X and Y. We need to specify this particular thing inside the parameters list. All right, so I will write here, say, event, comma, X, comma, Y. Now, what is X and Y? Whenever you are putting one specific point on that window, right, you will actually end up getting the pixel values. You will end up getting the pixel values from that image. Okay, that is what it is doing. All right, pretty simple. Don't get confused. You will just put up the pixel values. And those values are actually returned by cv2.line. This X, Y, whatever it is there, it is actually returning the value from set mouse callbacks. The whole function of set mouse callback is actually to give the value of X and Y. The point, wherever this particular cursor is, right? What is this particular cursor point? It can be anything in coordinate geometry axis value, right? This is what we need to specify. And along with this, I need to specify, say, flags and param. These are the optional parameters, but then we need to write it down to get the proper output, all right? That's it. This is what I have done. And once this particular thing is done, I will save this image or I will save this code. And let me type in here, say, P3 mouse event. All right. And then after this is saved, let me run it. You should be able to see the output now. Let's see whether we are getting the output or not. Yes, this is the final output which I have got. And okay, I'm not able to get a line here, black color line. Let's see what have I done wrong. I will have to check what wrong have I done. Let's see. So I have given here all of these things clearly. Okay, why we need extra 50 pixels? That's a good question, Jarina. So basically, see here, whenever you are putting a line, right? I'll just open up Paint and show you this. This will be really interesting to understand. So just give me a moment. Let me open up Paint. All right, so Paint is open, I guess. So if you are putting a line, right, you need how many coordinates? You need two coordinates, right? See, this is a straight line which I'm putting. So consider that this particular thing is one axis, right? This particular point, whatever I have, this is one point. I can call it as X, Y, right? This is X, Y. But if I need this particular value, okay, this can't be X, Y. This one will be what? The X axis will remain same, right? But then, sorry, the X, Y axis will remain same, but then X axis will contain one specific value, right? So I have actually plotted a line like this, wherein this is X, Y. This one will be X plus 50, Y plus 50. Okay, are you understanding, Jarina, why we need this particular value? If I give X, Y same thing, then there won't be any difference. Are you understanding? There won't be any difference in getting the output. It is just like you are putting a point. It will be just like then you are putting a point. You don't need a point. You need a line, right? So for getting the line, you need two different things. You need, say, this particular thing to come out in one specific value. And then apart from that, you also need to make sure that at the end, there is another value which is available. I hope this is clear, right? Okay, why am I not getting the output? Let me check once again. So I have written here cv2.line. Okay, this is the first thing. Let me check. Did I miss any specific point? cv2.line. Okay, open up. So, okay, I think so. I've missed here. First one is image, second one is 0.1, 0.2, and then afterwards it is color, and afterwards it is thickness. Why isn't it coming then? So let me give here, say, 255. And now let me check. invalid syntax. One second. Okay, which one did I give? It is using left button down. Okay, left button down, it should work. Still, it's not working. Okay, I will just try to increase this particular thing to say 5. And now let me check. Okay, I think so. The point is we should actually run this particular thing. In maybe, you know, it will be better if we could run this in true. Yes. So I will change this particular thing a little bit. I will tweak this particular thing a little bit because since you want to see the output interaction, right, it should be actually put up in a forever loop. All right. So I will type in here, say while of true. All right, this is what I need to write. And afterwards, I will put all of this in, say, tab. Okay. And here I will specify a condition. If, say, cv2.wait key, all right, is equal to, let me specify here, say, ORD, ordinal value of Q is what I will write. Okay. It returns the Unicode anyways. And if I type in Q only, then it should break. Okay. This is what it specifies. And it should break. I will give here, say, one specific millisecond as the value to break. And now hopefully it should work because it is interaction. It should be, you know, changing every now and then. Hopefully now it should work. Yes, that was the point, or that was something which we had not done. Okay, now you will get the output. See here, this is the line which we need to work upon, right? So I'll specify once again what is the change which you'll have to work upon. So I need to make sure that it runs in a forever loop because you are actually calling a function, and that particular function change whatever you are doing, it should be written in our code, right? So you need to specify a forever loop. I'm specifying a forever loop here, and I'm taking a condition saying that only when I specify Q from the keyboard, the ordinal value of Q, it should break. That means it should destroy the window. All right. This thing is important, without which you will not get the output. But now if you see here, I think so you are getting the output. So final output, see here, I am able to put whatever the line I want. Okay. I'm able to actually put this particular thing. All right. There you go. This is how you actually play around with it. And if in case you are worried about why we are getting blue color, let me tell you, CV2, whatever the library we are using, it works upon, say, BGR scale. There is something called as BGR, blue, green, red. Okay, so if you specify 255 here, it is considered as blue value. If you want red value, you can specify, say, 255 here. Make this particular thing as 0 and it will work. All right, so there you go. Now, let me run this and show you. You will get red color. Fine. I hope this is clear. You can play around with the values also. You can please play around with different values. The whole point is same set mouse callbacks actually calls X and Y value. Okay. That is what it does. All right. So we don't need to play around with a line. We either need a circle or a square, right? I will now go ahead with circle. I will now maybe, you know, change this particular thing. Let me put this in, say, hash. And I will put, say, cv2.circle. Yes, Garina, we are going towards blur. I just wanted to tell you how exactly it works. All right, we'll go slowly to that particular thing also. So first thing is image. The second thing is we need the center of radius, right? So the center of circle, let me just give x, y. And afterwards, I need to specify what is the radius. I will specify radius to be 30 pixels. And then afterwards, I will specify, say, 255, 0, 255. Say I want mixture of, you know, blue and red color. Okay, this is what I've taken. I think so I'll get yellow. And I will specify thickness to be 1. Okay, this is what I need to do. And let me just run it and check what we are getting. So if you see here, okay, sorry, you'll not get yellow. You'll get pink color, right? It's a mixture of blue and this one. So you end up getting this blue color, right? This is what we are, pink color. This is what we are getting. All right, now that we know how to get a circle, our main aim is to blur, right? I know that with the help of this, I can blur, but I don't want to blur just like this, right? I don't want to blur based on this. I want to, let me open up paint and show you. So say I have got black color here, okay? I will take a circle. Let me take a circle here. Not circle, okay. Let me take, say, eraser tool. Okay, eraser is in this particular thing, right? Now let us understand how this eraser works. All right, this is something very important because this is where we actually create a canvas. All right, so how will this eraser work? If I press left click, okay, it is working. I know that it is working, right? But then when I move around, is it working? It is not working. Okay, when I move around leaving the left click, is it working? No, it doesn't work. When I do left click, it is working. Okay, now instead of giving the value of x and y, I can maybe, you know, just feed in, say, the image blur, whatever the blurring has to be done. I can just feed it and it will get blurred. But then I don't want to blur just like this, right? How should I blur? I need to blur those values. Imagine I am rotating the values, or say, imagine I'm rotating the mouse. When I'm rotating the mouse, with left click, it is moving around, right? How is the canvas created? This is something very important. I would say this is the most important part of the class because the logic is very important here, all right? See, blurring can be very easily done. If you do left click, it is done. But then I don't just want to do blurring when it is doing left click, or I don't want a circle or a square to come when it is doing only left click. Along with left click, when I rotate, even then I should get the output. Are you understanding what it should happen? When I rotate, even then it should actually come. When I'm moving around my mouse, I should get the output. Now tell me, which mouse event do you think I should work? See here, I have shown you already left button down, okay? Apart from left button down, which mouse event do you think I need to make sure that my canvas is working just like an eraser? Okay, see here, we are applying the logic of eraser here. If we understand eraser, we will be able to blur out whatever we need. Instead of doing only left click, we can move around properly and play around with it. Which one of the following mouse events do you think we need to actually work upon? Left button down, okay, we need it. That is the first thing. But along with left button down, which one? Which is the other one which you think is very important? Which is the other mouse event which we need? Yes, definitely we need mouse move, right? Only once we have mouse move and left button down together, we can actually play around with it and work on blur, right? So we will use mouse move also. And let us check how to use this mouse move. Again, this is going to be pretty simple. I will just copy this and I will paste it here. Let me paste it here, say mouse move. Right here, say mouse move. This is what I will do, okay? And I will end up getting the output. Now, once these two things are done, let me save it and let me run and let me check whether it is working or not. So see here, when I'm moving my mouse, I am actually getting the pink color value, whatever it is there. But then do you think we need something like this? Do you think we need something like this? Should it move whenever you do more, whenever you move your mouse, do you think you should get the output? You should not get the output whenever you are moving, right? You should get the output, or you should get the circle only when you do left click and move around. Are you understanding? Only when you do left click and when you move around. These two things are separate, right? Only when you do left click and when you move around, you need to get the output. Okay, so what we need to do, we are doing something wrong here. We should actually change our code in such a way that only once we do left click and move around, we need to get the output. So how do you do that particular thing? Sir, there is command line argument required. See, Shubhankar, if you want to use command line argument, you can use it. Okay, but I will not be focusing on that. Okay, I will not be focusing anything on command line. I will be telling you in plain how exactly this particular thing is done. Okay, you can definitely see there are 1,000 ways of writing one specific kind of code. All right. But then my way might be different from your way, okay? It can be completely different. The whole point is we need to get the output. It doesn't matter which way you use, right? There might be, 100 lines of code, or is the same 100 line of code, you can actually do it with, say, 50 lines of code. You can actually use only 20 lines of code also. Maybe, you can work around it. Work on optimization. That's where you will learn a lot of things. Okay, now how do I actually use the, I know I need to use conditional statement, but then how do I use it? Okay, so let's understand the logic first of all. See, you have a mouse. When you do left click, it should work. This is absolutely fine. Yes, this is working. It will work. But then this particular mouse move should only work when you have done left button down. Only when you have done left button down, it should work. Otherwise, it should not work. That is where we need to actually consider additional, status, or we can call it as a status register. If you are someone from microcontroller, you might have definitely heard about the concept of status registers. Okay, what is the use of this status registers? It actually tells you what is the status of that particular register, right? Whether it is on or off. We can also call them as flags, right? There is something called as flag, right? So it tells you whether your register bit is 1 or 0. We need to do the same thing. We need to check whether our register bit is 1 or 0. So for that, pretty simple. I will take one specific variable. Let me call that variable as, say, state underscore circle. Okay, state, or let me write state underscore mouse. Now this state underscore mouse, since I want to check the I want to check the status. The best way to check status, which data type should we use for checking the status? See, status can be either open or close. Either it is using or not using. So we need to use Boolean here. All right. So I will specify false in the beginning. What do you mean by false? It actually tells me whether my button, left button. Okay, let me write here, say, I will not write mouse. I will write, say, left button. Okay. Whether my left button is on or off. By default, it will be in off state. All right. I will turn it on only when I am using this particular event here before even printing. All right. Let me remove this. It is confusing. I will just put here, say, state underscore left. When, if you click the mouse, if you do left button click, then what should happen? It should actually consider the value of state underscore left b to be true. Okay, this is what it should consider. Are you understanding? This is what we need to do. This is the first point. All right, it is now on. When is it on? Only when you do left button click, it is on. All right, now when do you think mouse move should be on? Mouse move should be on only if this status is on. All right, so what I'm gonna do is I will take another if condition here. I will just cut this and put it at the end. If in case anyone needs this, let me keep it like this. Here inside this, I will take another if condition. That means I'm taking nested if. Are you understanding? A condition inside a condition is called as nested condition. Nested if statement is what I'm taking. So inside this, I will specify if the state underscore left b, okay? If this is equal to true, if whatever it is there, it is equal to true, only then I should actually run a circle. Okay, is that clear? Only then I should run a circle. If this is there, only then let it run a circle. Or else what it should happen? Or else nothing should happen, right? So I will come out of this and here I will specify, say, else, let me make my state value to be false, because it should be false in the left out stage. It should be false. And I will change this particular thing to elif because I'm taking multiple conditions, right? Okay. Yeah. So this is what I do. Please check here what I have done. I have taken here left button down event. All right. And then I have taken a status. First of all, the status will be false. And I'm taking normal if, elif, and else. See here, the outer indentation is very important here. The outer conditions, it includes if the event is left button down, then the status will be true. Else if the button event is, say, mouse move, then it will check whether the state button, what is it? Is it true or false? If the state is true, then it will allow you to work on it. If it is false, then it will not do anything. Then else, if you leave everything, if you're not doing anything, then the button state should be returned to false so that it comes back to the original state. Okay, this is how it actually works upon. And when I'm running the program, there is required to give for system argument. When you're not using system argument, then why you need to give that particular thing? Shubhankar, that is my question. If you are using it, then obviously you need to run that particular command, right? But then I have not specified your system.argument anywhere in my coding, right? So system.argument, I have not specified, then you don't need to use any command line thing. But then if there is something like that in your program, if you are working on your personal project, then definitely you need to specify that particular thing. Otherwise, you can't run the program, right? So, okay. So now that I have done this particular thing, let us check whether our output is working or not. All right. I will save it and let me run. Okay. Let's see. Okay. I am getting an error here. It says local variable. All right. So the problem here is if you are using any function, right? You are using a variable which is outside. You need to consider that particular thing to be global. Just specify here, say global of say state underscore left. Right, save it and then you run. Now hopefully you should get the output. Here, when I'm moving my mouse, I'm not getting. When I do left click, I'm getting. Okay, wait. I think so. There is something even more wrong. It should not come like this. When I'm moving, I should not get it. All right, there is something wrong. Let's see. Where did we go wrong? So this particular thing is working absolutely fine. Okay, here I have not changed it. I should assign it. I should not compare it, right? I should assign this particular thing. Now I think so it should work. So let me run the code now once again. And left click, yes. And left and move around, it is working, right? Left, move around, it is working. Fine, there you go. This is how you actually need to work upon. This is the base logic, and now on top of it we will just apply the blur filter. All right, we will just apply the blur filter on top of it so that we get the output. All right, I will stop till here. I want you guys to actually check properly and let me know whether you are getting the code properly or not. I want you guys to let me know whether you are getting the code properly or not. And after this is done, now it will be pretty simple. The only part which we need to apply, we need to actually put up, say, the blur value. Whatever the blur value it is there, we need to put it. That's it. That is how it will work. So please let me know whether you are getting the output. And please let me know if you have understood this also or not. Okay, so if you have understood this, we can play. We can just move around with our final blur project. Hello, Hema. I think so you just joined. Okay, if you're getting the output, please type in done. If you're getting the output, please type in done. Yes, understood, and it's working. That's great, Pragati. Okay, what about other people? Done. Okay, Kriti says done. All right, that's great. So I'll wait for another minute so that we can put on the final this one. All right, so let's continue. I think so everyone is getting the output. The next thing what I'm gonna do is I'll just add up, say, filter, right? I need to add up the filter value now, that's it. So how can we add that filter? So I will specify here after this particular thing, let me specify the part which has to be blurred, right? I don't want to blur each and every part. I want to blur only that part which I am specifying now. Okay, so for that, I will write in here, say part as my variable, and then I will specify, say, cv2 dot. Let me write blur, okay, because we were using cv2 blur. If you want, you can use Gaussian blur also, but then yes, cv2 blur should be fine. And after this is done, okay, sorry, before even writing cv2 dot blur, I need to specify here the part, right? Which part am I blurring? So I will write, say, img of whatever x value from x is to say x plus, I will take a small amount, let me write say 20, comma y is to y plus 20. Okay, this is the say rectangle size which I am taking. All right, I will not be using now this particular circle. I will be taking the part of my image from this cropped one. Okay, this is the image which I will be taking. Okay, now that I have taken this particular thing, the next thing what I will have to do is I will have to write here, say, maybe blur as my variable is equal to, I will write cv2.blur. Okay, and inside this, I need to specify two things. One is the source, right? Now the source will be part because I want to blur only that particular part which is available. And then the second thing which I want to specify is the kernel size, right? So let me specify kernel size to be say 3, 3. Okay, if you want to, or else let me give a huge one. I will give say 5, 5 because we should check, right? We should know what exactly are we doing. So I will specify 5, 5 as the blur part. Okay, now that I have done these two things, I should actually mix up. I should make sure that it is mixed properly with the say original image. So I need to write in here, say this particular part, I need to assign it to say the value of blur. Okay, this is what I need to do. All right, these three lines of code I'm adding, and this one I no longer need it because I have taken here already a rectangle. I no longer need a circle. All right, I hope this is clear. These three lines of code is what I am writing. The first thing is the part which I need to blur. The second thing is that particular part I need to pass through a filter of blur. And then afterwards, I need to make sure that the blurred part is actually mixed with the original image. All right. Once this is done, copy this. And also, you can put the same thing inside this circle. Instead of this circle, just paste it here and make sure that you give proper indentation. Okay. That's it, guys. This is what you need to do. Let's see whether our code is working fine or not. So I will give F5 and let me check. So see here, I am actually able to blur out. Okay, wait. I think so. I need to change something. All right. I think so. I need to change here X with Y. But then, yes, you are getting somewhat kind of output, but then it is not matching up properly. So I need to change X and Y. Only then you will end up getting proper this one. Okay, so what I'll do is I will go back to this and here just change X to Y and Y to X. Okay, you will end up you will get proper results. So X and copy and paste everywhere. Control V. Okay, so Control V. Control V. Okay, that's it. This will be the code. And let me run it. You should get the proper blurring. See here, you are actually now able to blur whatever you need. Okay, where did I go wrong? Something wrong. Error assertion failed. I think so. There is no problem. Yeah, that's okay. But then, yes, there you go. Now you are getting the output. Here I am blurring whatever part I need to blur. I can just blur it very well. Okay, there you go. I can just blur whatever I needed. Fine, that's it. That is the output which we were talking about. All right. So that's the code, guys. Please check it out. What I have done, I have put, instead of a circle, I have put a rectangle. Okay. And I have taken this particular thing as my rectangle, whatever it is there. All right. And you can definitely extend it to the several new variations. You can come up with your own set of, you know, a varied value for this particular thing. Maybe, you know, instead of square, you can put up a circle and also vary the kernel sizes, play around with that. What I'm going to do right now is I will take the previous image, pick is what I will take. Let me run this. And I will show you something which, you know, many people use for photoshopping, right? So say I want only this particular person in the image, okay? And all of the other things to be blurred. What do? I start, can you see here? I'm actually blurring it, okay? So I might not be doing this properly, but then yes, I just want to tell you how exactly this particular thing is working. Okay, now that next time you are going forward with any of the image blurring application, you should understand what exactly is happening behind the scenes. What exactly is happening? It is nothing but a filter which is passed, right? So it's I think so time for you to see the technology in a different way, right? So that's the aim of ours. We need to educate more and more people what exactly is the technology all about. So I am just blurring the other side. Okay, and let us check to do it. So yes, this is how I am blurring it. I will blur everything else except for this particular person, right? I am blurring everything else except for this particular person. Okay, I think so there is some sort of error here, but then yes, I think so it is clear for you, right? So yes, there might be some sort of errors. I think so. I'm getting here not responding kind of for this one, but then yes, I think so you have understood the whole point, what I was specifying regarding this. Can I blur one face in a video? Definitely, Shubhankar, you can do that. So in the last video, right, let me tell you how to do that particular thing also. In the last session of ours, if you go to say this particular thing, in the last session of ours, at the end, I had actually spoken about Haar cascade algorithm. All right. I had, you know, spoken about this Haar cascade algorithm. One second. I think I'll have to mute this. Let me just show you which I was talking about. Okay, so in the last part of this particular session, I was actually talking about, say, Haar cascade algorithm, wherein rectangle was actually formed. So instead of this rectangle, right, see, just see this particular code, you will understand for yourself. All right, so let me just check where exactly it is. So here, instead of rectangle coming up on the face, you can just put a blur. Okay, are you understanding? Instead of rectangle, see this particular part, instead of rectangle, just pass it with CV2 dot, just the same part, whatever I have done here. Okay, part, blur, whatever it is there, which blur you want from X is to Y, and then X plus 20 and Y is to 20 or whatever it is you can reach. Not even 20, sorry. You can already specify here with X plus H and Y plus W, right? This will actually take the face into consideration and it will, you know, put the blur on that particular face, right? That will be a very good, super impressive application, Shubhankar, of this particular thing, all right? You can definitely do that. Can we return the outline and blur the remaining? Okay, I didn't get this, Pratik. Can we return the outline? What do you mean by that? Can you make your question more specific so that I can keep it properly? I can give you a proper answer. Can we return the outline and blur the remaining? Okay, are you saying that in this particular image, whatever I have taken, It has to actually recognize the outline of this particular thing and remain blur all the other things. Can we return the outline and blur the remaining, then portrait effects? Yes, definitely you can do it. But then for that, you will have to little bit improve on your coding skills. All right. You will have to, code it in such a way that it first detects the outline and then it gives you the output. You will have to mix two filters here. You will have to first take the outline filter and then you will have to put it on top of, other blurring filter. You need to do two things, right? Definitely, Pratik, what you have told is absolutely wonderful application. But then, yes, you will have to write a code in such a way that, it takes up two values into consideration or two blurring effects into, sorry, two filters into consideration. Okay. So, okay, sir, can we deploy this model using Streamlit as we do in last session? So, see, this complete thing in Streamlit, I have personally not tried it, but then definitely you can play around with that. I'm coming up with another session. I will try to actually deploy maybe, something related to the next OpenCV class. I will try to actually deploy something on Streamlit wherein maybe, you can play around with, say, some quotes and then detect what exactly that particular quotes are actually trying to tell you. Convert image into text, something like that I'm planning. And during that time, I will try to deploy this particular thing onto the cloud. You can definitely deploy it onto the cloud. But then one point, Pratyush, which I don't know is of this mouse event, whether Streamlit support mouse events or not. That is what we will have to check. All right. But apart from that, definitely all the other things, definitely it can be done. The only point which I'm not sure is of mouse event, because this is very specific, right? The mouse event thing is very specific. And only based on mouse event, you can actually consider one specific part of the code. The previous one, whatever we had done, the complete this one, you can just specify the blurring thing. You can definitely do it. Okay. But then the mouse event, I'm not sure because I'm not worked on it. All right. You can please try it out and let me know as well if it works. Definitely. It will be something very good. All right. So any other questions, guys, regarding this? If you have any other questions, please do let me know. I will try to answer you that. Let me check if I have worked upon the faces image blur. I'm not sure whether I've worked on, whether I have got this. I had saved one. Let me check. Okay. No, I think so. I am not having that particular hard cascade. Otherwise, I wanted to actually show you that particular thing. I don't have it right now. It is somewhere there. Okay. Oh, okay. What is this? So once again, explain how to blur something in video. So see, for video, again, you will have to take up that hard cascade thing. Okay. If you remember the hard cascade, I think so. I have got the code for hard cascade. Let me show you that. And for that particular hard cascade thing, you will have to actually, apply. You will have to apply. Let me check. I think so. I had worked on this. Let me check. If it is available, I can show you the output completely. One second. Gaussian simple. No, this is a simple Gaussian blur. I'm not able to find that hard cascade thing also. Yes. So this is the hard cascade thing which we have. And see here, this is what we have, right? The values, whatever we have, we get it from, say, multi-scale here. Just instead of cv2.rectangle, right, whatever the values, whatever the image value you are taking, instead of rectangle, just specify the same thing what we had done here. Just specify this same thing what we have done here, exactly same thing, and it will consider the value. The blurring will actually come here. Instead of rectangle, the image value will come, or the blurring value will come here. Okay, the same thing can be done for video as well. I think so. Video, I don't have it right now with me, but then definitely it can be actually put up for video as well. Okay, wait, let me check whether it is there for video. Yes. So this is the video which I have from, say, webcam. Okay, if you open up your webcam, you will actually get the output here. Instead of, say, rectangle, what do we need? We need the blur filter. Just pass it through cv2.blur. If you are passing it through cv2.blur, and you can just mix up the same thing here, what exactly I have done, these three lines of code, if you specify there, right, you will get the output properly. You will get the exact same output there. Whenever a face is there, instead of a face, it will actually be blurred. Okay, exactly. You will have to mix up these two things. You need to actually first recognize the face. That is the first thing. All right. You need to make sure that you recognize the face. How do you recognize the face? You recognize the face with the help of hard cascade. The concept of hard cascade, I have actually explained in the previous session. In the previous session of OpenCV, you can please check that. I have explained how exactly hard cascade is being used. And then instead of a rectangle, I don't want a rectangle, right? Instead of a rectangle, I want the specific, say, I want the specific blurred image for that particular thing. Just remove the rectangle and put the blurring of that particular thing, and it will work out. Okay, is that fine, Yarina? You can just check this out, and that should work for you. All right, with that, guys, we will stop for today's session. That's it. I think so. There are no other queries. So our upcoming session is on a different topic a little bit. Let me open this up. And we are actually conducting a session on C++. So as you know, C++ is also one of the most popular language out there. So we thought of, you know, giving you guys a basic version of C++, but then we will try not to bore you with the one which we have studied in maybe, you know, our colleges. So it'll be a basic C++ tutorial, but then you will learn something interesting. It will be a very good, revision for you if you are already familiar with C++. If you are not, then please come to attend this particular session, and it will be really useful for you. So the link for registration is actually put up here. You can please go to this particular link and register for yourself. So yes, that is the announcement which I wanted to make. Our upcoming session is on C++ for beginners. And if this will be really helpful for you for, if someone is from placement, right? Someone is from, say, going for placement, maybe, they're attending placements, drives or something like that. So this will be really helpful for them. So please do attend our session, register yourself, and we'll see you guys in the upcoming session of this tutorial. All right. So again, the same timings, 11:30 to 1:30 is what we have. Yes, you can work on this. You can register yourself, guys, here. Okay, so now for today's feedback link, guys, let me tell you the procedure how you will have to give your feedback for your certificates also. So please pay attention to this. If you go to, say, image blurring, okay, go to this image blurring, the same thing which you are watching right now. And if you scroll down, you should be able to see here the link, okay? Please pay attention. Please pay attention. Feedback link will not open now. It will take at least 10 minutes after the end of session. It will take at least 10 minutes, okay, after I wrap up today's session. Okay, please pay attention. I don't want anyone to type in the comment section saying that feedback link is not working. It will not work. It will work only after I end today's session. That is why please pay attention to what I'm saying. Okay, so the link for feedback is given here, and it will be active till 8 p.m. Okay, till 8 p.m. tonight. Okay, you have a lot of amount of time to actually fill this particular feedback link. All right. So it is in this particular description itself. Please take your time and fill this feedback link. It will open only after 10 minutes. Okay, only after 10 minutes it will open. It will not open right now. It will open after 10 minutes after I finish my video streaming. All right, so don't tell me that feedback link is not working. It will not work now. It will work only after I finish the session. All right. So what you will have to do is you will have to make sure that you write session summary. Please go through this particular comment, what has been written here. You need to write what was covered today. Please don't write the session was good, the session was decent, the session was awesome. I don't want any of that particular thing. In the comments, you need to write regarding the session summary. Please write the session summary, what you have learned in today's session. Okay, you have learned about the process of blurring, how you can use this particular blur process, maybe, you know, to blur one specific image. And also you had seen mouse events regarding that. Please write a crisp summary what you have learned in today's session. Okay, don't write regarding the feedback of the session. For feedback, for if you want to give us a review, inside this you have got one specific link. Okay, inside this I will just open it and show you. So okay, wait, let me just open up and show you how it will be. All right, so there will be this particular link given for review, and this will actually open up. The review link for us will open up, and you can give your review here. Okay, so one second. Where is this? Yes, you will get this particular link, the feedback link. That means the review of this particular session, you will have to type in this particular say link of our Diazonic Labs Google review platform. Okay, you can write it here. The link for this is also given in the Google Forms itself. You can go through that and you can check it out. Ranadai, please listen to me. It will not work. I think so. You're not paying attention to what I'm saying. So I think so. I've already informed you regarding the feedback. Yes, this is what you need to do. Please make sure that you enter the session summary in the comment section. And also the feedback, whatever you want to give, you can give it in the Google reviews. All right. The link for that is also specified in the feedback link itself. I will open the feedback link only after 10 minutes after the session is done. So once again, I would request you to please like our video. If you have not done it, please do like the video, and also subscribe to our channel if you have not subscribed to our channel. Okay. So with that, I'm going to end today's session. With that, I will be stopping today's session, and please do fill in the feedback what is done. Amaida, not session summary, not to be written in the live chat. It should be written in the comment section. Please read the information properly if you want the certificates, guys. I have already told you enough times. So yes, with that, I will stop today's session, guys. And once again, please do register for C++ if you're interested in working on that. Okay. So with that, I will stop the session and I'll see you guys in the upcoming session. Thanks a lot, guys. Keep supporting us so that we bring you a lot of variant topics as well. All right. With that, I will stop today's session, guys. Thank you once again.